All right, let's try that again. Good morning. Good morning. There we go. That's better. That's better. That's better. That's better. For our friends who've gathered with us online, welcome to Fishing Creek Salem United Methodist Church. We're here for the 9:30 time of worship. We're here to celebrate, praise the Lord, worship the Lord. If you've been watching the screen, there are a multitude of announcements and things going on. The last day for egg production is this coming Wednesday, and from what I understand, the last day to pick up eggs is the 27th. So if you need your Easter eggs, or if you need to have your Easter eggs refilled, or if you need Easter eggs because you've been putting off getting Easter eggs, friends, the time is short. Folks that are with us online, if you are interested in eggs, please give us a call into the office. And you'll have to pick them up in a very tight window. This coming Sunday is Palm Sunday, which brings us into a time of Holy Week. Palm Sunday will celebrate Christ's arrival into Jerusalem. Thursday evening, we have a time of worship here. We'll be sharing a meal together. There will be pulled pork, from what I understand, and everybody is invited to bring something to share along with that. And then Friday, we'll be in the sanctuary, a tenebrae service, a festival of light into darkness. And then, of course, Sunday morning, sunrise service led by youth, right? Youth? Yes? Yes. Good. And then worship, two worship services following that. And I believe there's a breakfast brunch. Yes. Yes, gotta love breakfast brunch. Do we have any other announcements to share or anything else as we begin our time of worship together? Seeing none, please.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We are here, Ginger and I, for the blessing of the prayer shawls. The prayer shawl is a group that meets, I think, monthly.
Yes.
Yes.
Second Saturday of the month, if you're interested.
The second Saturday of the month. So, if you've not seen us bless the prayer shawls before, Ginger will read some of the names, and I think they will be quick to tell us that many of the prayer shawls that are made by our Salem Prayer Shawl group are from people outside of the community, outside in the community. So that is a blessing that we can help them and surround them with prayer. So I'll let you take that, and you can tell us, or here, I'll hold it for you, and you can move your cards.
Okay, today we're having shawls blessed for Billy, Joe, Alyssa, Karen, and Carol. If you would be interested, if you know of someone that you feel needs a shawl, These pink cards are all through the church. Or you can contact Susan Huntsberger. And if you fill out one of these cards, make sure you put your phone number on it. Very important. Thank you.
Okay. Here, I'm just going to bless them. Well, let us pray. In the beginning, Creator God, you formed us and knitted us together and gave us the breath of life. Send your blessing upon these prayer shawls and bless those who have woven them with your love, and bless those who receive them. May these shawls be a mantle of your healing presence and warmth of your mercy to the weary. In the name of Jesus, our healer, teacher, and savior, amen. Amen. Thank you very much. We'll slide that over. Awesome. Yeah, well, not in front of the speaker. I mean, not that they need any help, but okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning, Salem.
Good morning.
It's good to see everybody. Happy St. Patrick's Day. I can see a lot of green out there today.
Aye.
Boy, I tell you what, has anybody else been enjoying the weather this week? It was spring break, working at the university was great because, you know, normally I have to worry about if I have to jump from building to building, I got to walk in the cold. But, man, I tell you what, the weather was great. But the one thing I will say about the weather getting warmer is the farmers are out now. And anybody who lives in or around Goldsboro knows what I'm talking about. The smell. Boy, it's been a fight this week. Do we open up the house? Do we keep the house closed? Like, what's more important, the cool air or the smell? The cool air or the smell? What are we doing? So it's been, you know, fun trying to figure that out. But thankful for the weather. Would you please stand with us this morning? We are going to celebrate this morning as we enter into our message. Today is about giving up our lives. And this first song is, once we give up our lives, all we want to do is shout and praise his name and shout it from the rooftops this morning, shall we?
Place into you.
Compares to you. You alone are good. You are worthy of our praise. Thank you for creating us, calling us by name, and giving us a purpose. We are in awe of your love and grace. Fill us with a deep desire to know you, to serve you in your name. Forgive us times that we have not trusted you. Give us courage to do your will. Our hearts are open to receive you, Lord, to hear from our hearts, to hear our worship and our prayers. So hear us now. Show us, O God, how we can glorify your name in this world. We give ourselves away. You can use us. Here we stand, Lord. Our lives are in your hands.
life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you. I give myself to you.
Amen. You may be seated.
There are two scripture lessons today. The first scripture lesson is from Ezekiel 37. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them. But there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come breathe, come breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army." Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up, and our hope is gone, and we're cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, This is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you and you will live. And I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord.
The second reading for today is John 11, verses 11 to 45. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sister sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. When he heard this, Jesus said, This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, Let us go back to Judea. But Rabbi, they said, a short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you are going back. Jesus answered, Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. It is when a person walks at night that they stumble, for they have no light. After he had said this, he went on to tell them, Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better. Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Then Thomas said to the rest of the disciples, Let us also go, that we may die with him. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world. After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and he is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews had been with Mary in the house comforting her and noticed how quickly she got up and went, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Then Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this, for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him.
So for these weeks that we've been here in the season of Lent, we've been talking about giving up different things. We talked about giving up control. We talked about giving up expectations. We talked about giving up superiority. And we talked about giving up enemies. And this week, we look at the notion of giving up our lives. You know, God created life from death, from nothingness, from hopelessness. The Bible is full of such stories. And Jesus tells us that those who try to keep their lives will die, but those who give up their lives for others will live. We see that Jesus teaching that in several pieces of Scripture, John 12, Luke 17, Matthew 16. And oftentimes we're accustomed to thinking of life in the terms of beginning and life in terms of an end, of a time when it's finished. And we look at that time span in between there of what we have been able to accomplish, what we've been able to do on this earth. But we need to think of it in a different way. We need to think of life in a different manner, in a different understanding. We need to kind of throw away that piece and think about giving up our lives for God. Giving up our lives that we know on this earth, living in a certain way, acting in a certain way, giving them up for Christ. I know, giving up our lives sounds kind of final. It sounds like an ending. It sounds like the end of a movie or of a book. Something that maybe John Williams may be playing the theme for at the end. In case you're not sure who John Williams is, think of the theme from Jaws. Think of Indiana Jones, Raiders of the Lost Ark. Think of Star Wars. Those are the theme music that John Williams has created. That would be a theme for our lives. You can just imagine it playing. Hearing that as our life ends. But we're not talking about ending a life. We're talking about ending a life that we know here on earth and giving our life up for Christ. It's different. We're talking about giving our life up for Christ. It's a new way of living, a new way of thinking, a new way of being born again and living a life that is full of the Lord, a life that is new and full and complete. Two scripture references for today. First one from Ezekiel. God sent Ezekiel to that land, that vast plain where all the bones had been there, drying in the sun. And he said, prophesy to them. The Spirit of the Lord came upon them and they formed back into new bodies. The Spirit of the Lord filled them and they were able to breathe again. New life was created from something that was old and thought lost. If you look at the scripture, it's the aspect of Israel being lost and being born anew. But I think we could also look to it ourselves, friends. Where have our lives been lost? Where have we been those dry bones? Where have we been thinking that we have no connection whatsoever? But yet when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon us, when the Spirit of the Lord fills us, we are made new. We are strengthened. We are renewed. We are born again in that manner. The Lord gave them new life through Him. And it's the same with us, friends. We have new life in Christ. Second reading. We're looking at Jesus' ultimate power of life over death. And I think the verse that really jumps out to you is this verse. Did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God? It's about belief, friends. It's about our belief, our way of changing our lives in and through that belief. And this makes it very clear to all who were there to experience it, and all of us who have been sharing this scripture, the amazing power in life through Christ Jesus. And you might be thinking, oh, that's great. Those are good stories. That's great, great scripture there, Pastor. But how does that apply to me? What does that have to do with my life? Friends, it's about our belief. It's about our walk of faith. It's about our trust and engagement in the Lord. It's about where we are in our walk with the Lord. How much have we given up? And how much more do we have to give up? To be changed, to be made new. To think of that aspect of eternal life. In our confirmation class this past week, we talked about grace and mercy. Grace and mercy may seem similar, but yet they're related to each other, but yet there's a difference. And this is the easiest explanation. Grace is when you get the good things you don't deserve. Grace is available for everyone. Mercy is when you are spared from the bad things that you do deserve and that God is generous with both of them. Friends, that is in our relationship to God. There's grace that existed before we even knew God, and it's up to us to make that choice to embrace that new life in Christ. Grace is freely given through the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, that ultimate gift, that ultimate sacrifice for us all. And it's our choice to live in a new way. It's our choice to proclaim Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. It is our choice to find and have this new life in Christ. It's interesting in Scripture, we can find so many examples of what this means to us. And we're going to look at a couple examples of wise choices and a couple examples of not wise choices so that we can see and have an understanding of what we're talking about here. The first is from Mark chapter 10. And this is where this rich young man comes up to Jesus and says, "What must I do to get eternal life?" And Jesus says simply, well, you know, obey all the commandments, love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, do not commit murder, do not commit adultery, all those commandments that are available for all of us. And the young man says, "I've done all those, Lord. I've done all those. What more do I need to do?" Jesus said, "Okay. Go and sell everything that you have. Go and sell everything that you have and give all that money to the poor." And the young man was devastated because that's where his heart was. His heart was in that wealth, that excess that he had. Jesus knew that and said, "Okay, you need to give all that up and you need to put your heart where it belongs. You need to give all of that, giving up yourself to God." And the young man goes away because it was just too much for him to bear. It was too much for him to give away. So the disciples asked Jesus, they said, "Okay, explain this to us. Is it not possible then for someone who is wealthy to enter into the kingdom of heaven?" Jesus said, "It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven, because it's about where their heart is. It's about what is most important." And Jesus says to them finally, "With man, it isn't possible, but with God, everything is possible." And in that moment, in that aspect, if that young man would have just listened and given up everything that he had, put his heart right, all would have been made well. And that's a challenge that we face, friends. Where are our lines drawn? Where do we make that choice? Where do we give up and give it all to God? Another reading. It's found in the Gospel of Mark, 12th chapter. And I'm going to read this scripture. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put, and he watched a crowd putting their money into the temple offerings. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came in and put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They gave out of their wealth, but she gave out of her poverty, putting in everything, all that she had." In that aspect, the wealthy gave out of their excess. They didn't give out of love. They didn't give out of honor and respect. They gave out of their excess so that others would see what they were doing. But in this moment, this widow gave all that she had out of love, out of faith, out of devotion, out of commitment, out of an understanding and knowledge of what it means to give it all to God. giving it all to God. But there are also several readings in Scripture of where the opposite example is given. First reading is from Luke 16. There was a rich man dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate there laid a beggar covered in sores. And that beggar longs to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick at his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abram's side in heaven. The time came that the rich man died and was buried. And he went to Hades. He was filled with torment. And he looked up so far away and saw Abraham with this man, this beggar who had been at his gates for all these years. And he called out, "Father Abraham, have pity on me. Send that man to dip the finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in agony here." But Abram replied, "Son, remember, in your lifetime, you received all those good things, and this poor man received all the bad things. Now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. And there is a great chasm between us that none can pass over." Choices that were made. This man who had exceeding wealth lived of life, but didn't share anything with God. Lived a life but couldn't even give to the very beggar that was at his gate, showing him no love whatsoever. And that man, the beggar, was carried into eternity with God. And that rich man, because of the choices that he made during his lifetime, was to spend eternity in hell. Another example of poor choices. Ananias and Sapphira. It's found in the book of Acts, chapter 5. Ananias and Sapphira had a big piece of property. And as they were selling that property, they made a promise. "We're going to give all the money that we have from this property to help the church grow. We're going to give all this money to help the church grow and glory to God." And after they'd sold the property, they decided to keep a little bit for themselves, tuck it in their pocket. So when it came time and they came to Peter, Peter asked a question, "Hey, did you sell all that property?" "Yep, here it is. Here's all the proceeds from that property. We're giving it all to you. We're giving it all to God." And in that moment, it was recognized how much he was lying. And in that moment, he forfeited his life. Because the promise that he made was not the promise that was fulfilled. A little bit later, his wife Sapphira comes. "Hey, did you sell our property?" "Yeah, we sold it all. My husband brought all the money to you. We gave you everything that we have." Again, Sapphira knowing that they held something back. And in that moment, her life was forfeit also. Choices that were made. Promises that were made, but promises that were not kept. We all have those choices, friends. We all have those choices in our lives, of where we can make that decision to give it all to God, giving of our very selves to God, changing how we think, how we act, how we react, what we say. Those are choices that we have in our lives. wise choices or poor choices. It's up to us to make that commitment. Last scripture I'm going to share is where Paul's writing a letter to the church at Colossae. That's Colossians chapter 3. And you have to understand, Paul was never there. He only heard stories about the amazing lives that were being changed in the church. But in that church, they were struggling. Some fully believed, fully gave of themselves. Others were holding back a little bit. Others weren't fully engaged. They weren't fully committed. And there was a struggle that was going on there in that church. And Paul's writing to them a letter of encouragement. Here's some of those verses. Since you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things that are above, where Christ is. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, idolatry. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old ways and put on a new life in Christ. Be filled. Clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. Bear with each other. Forgive one another. Forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. And above all these things, share the love of Christ. There are several very important thoughts in those verses of that letter. Set your hearts on things above. Things above where Christ is. Set your mind on things above, those heavenly things, not on earthly things. Allow your lives to be changed in and through that choice that's made. Clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. Bear with one another, forgive one another. And over all these things, put on love, the love of Christ. Let peace of Christ rule in our hearts. Because where our heart is, that's where the most important things are. We have choices to make in our lives, friends. The biggest choice that we can make is to give ourselves up to God. To be born anew, to be made new, to be a new creation in God, fully and completely, not holding anything back. And sharing the love of God with everyone on this earth. We're coming up to a time of where Jesus didn't hold anything back. He didn't try to sidestep anything that had been set aside and planned for him. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, the glorious and amazing entrance into Jerusalem. Thursday evening, we'll be sharing a meal here. Pulled pork is going to be available, and everyone is invited to bring something to share as part of that meal. We'll gather at the tables. But then following that sharing of a meal, we'll share in the meal of Holy Communion. Celebrating that time together. Everyone is welcomed that evening. Friday evening is Tenebrae service, a festival of light into darkness. We'll be over in the sanctuary for that piece. Sunday morning, resurrection service, sunrise service, resurrection services in the sanctuary and here. As we walk through this last week of Christ's life on this earth, and we get to that Resurrection Sunday, that amazing, glorious time. All these weeks we've been talking about giving up, not just for these 40 days of Lent, but a permanent change in our lives. Friends, I invite you to choose wisely. To choose wisely and be a new being in Christ. Now and forevermore. Amen and amen.
Good morning. I arrive early sometimes here to Salem. One reason that gets me up early in the morning is that my son has weightlifting before school. It's called football practice in quotes because, you know, the PIAA says you can't have football practice yet. But anyway, I'm up early and I'm pulling in and there are cars already in the parking lot on Monday morning. And that would be those who are participating in the, what I call the labor of love, egg making. It is labor intensive. Candy making of any kind is labor intensive when you're making it by hand. I'm a caramel maker, so it takes a while to patiently wait till that caramel turns color. It takes time, and I don't think people realize sometimes how much goes into making our eggs. But I'd like to think more goes into making our eggs than just the labor of it, that our real special ingredient is the love we have in the process of making it, and then the faithfulness we have in this church. There may be many reasons why someone would want to participate in volunteering their mornings or morning to make eggs. Maybe they just like cooking. Maybe they like to busy their hands. Maybe they enjoy the fellowship of the people around them. But I know when I walk into this room, it's always very briefly because I have other things I need to take care of too. But both Pastor Randy and I acknowledge the faithfulness that people have in this church. Their faithfulness to God, their faithfulness to Salem, their faithfulness to one another, and their faithfulness in this community. And we thank you. We thank you. May God continue to bless the hearts and the hands of people who would come together and share in some kind of an activity like that. But may we always be busy about our hands, but most of all of our hearts, to do labors of love. So, every Sunday morning we get to do our own labor of love. We get to show our faithfulness in receiving our tithes and our offering, which we'll do right now. Thank you much. can't pinch me today. I have my dachshund leprechaun socks on. So. Let us pray. From your hands, O God, come the blessings that make life possible, even the very gift of life itself. In gratitude and thanks, receive from our hands and our hearts this portion, this labor of love. Bless it, that by your Spirit's leading, we may use these gifts to bless the lives of others with the assurance of your love, the promise of your hope, and the course of your justice. This we do to your glory in the name of Jesus Christ, whoever goes before us in this holy season, leading us in your will and your way, and teaching us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you please stand as we close this morning?
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me all my days. I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. So, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. So, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running. Laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running. faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. In all my life you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. We'll sing of the goodness of God.
The power of hell forever.
Bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Amen.
Amen. Powerful as ever. Friends, we have been in this time together sharing in worship. We've been in this time together thinking about the aspect of giving up our lives for Christ, of being made new, of being a new creation in and through Him. Friends, I invite you, encourage you to make that choice, not only just during this time of Lent, these days of where we always do something different, but for all of our lives, for all time, to give of ourselves for God. So friends, go in peace and service to the Lord, giving thanks for all that He has done. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen and amen. Go in peace, friends.
For God so loved the world that He gave us, His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved the world.
Happy St. Patty's Day to you all.